a ritual begins that introduces a new generation of smallmouth bass. But long before the first wave of spawners hits the shallows, preparation and development has already begun. It actually happens within a few months after the spawn. The female will begin to develop eggs again. By the time a smallmouth reaches sexual maturity, their lives are designed around reproduction. By mid-fall, smallmouths start a feeding binge that won't stop until the water drops below 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Forage changes from crayfish and gobies to anything that'll fit in their mouth. Smelt, cisco, shad, shiners, any bait fish is fair game. From late September to freeze-up, a smallmouth can gain more than 20% of its total weight. This feeding binge can continue while migrating to deep winter holes where they'll lie dormant for the winter months. Energy stored from the fall feeding will last them through the winter. Through the winter, some species maintain their food intake, such as perch, whitefish, and lake trout. But smallmouth eat sparingly through the winter, if at all. But once the water warms, they resume their feeding binge in preparation for the spring spawn. Reversing their fall migration path, they begin to stage in larger schools closer to traditional spawning areas. When the water temperatures reach approximately 60 degrees Fahrenheit, the males will move to the shallows and select a bedding site. They'll return to the same approximate location year after year to spawn, typically making the bed in gravel or sand. He'll carve the bed with his tail, move rocks with his lips. His scarred lips and worn down tail will recover in the weeks ahead. Once the water conditions and temperatures are suitable and typically triggered by a full moon cycle, the first wave of spawners will start the ritual. Typically, larger fish will spawn first. Finally, the water waltz begins with the male trying to herd the female into the bed. Several beds might be in close proximity. A female's eggs won't all mature at once. She may service several beds. Once she's finished, she'll fall off into deeper water to recover. The female will be carrying between 2,000 and 20,000 eggs. A fish of about 18 inches long will probably have between 15 and 20,000 eggs. She'll deposit between 30 and 50 eggs at a time in 30-second to 1-minute intervals. The male is often on double duty, fertilizing the eggs and fending off the predators. The high protein of embryonic smallmouth is a target for invasive species or predators waiting in the wings for the first eggs to be dropped. Once the female has dropped all of her eggs, she'll move off to deeper water to recover. When eggs are first deposited, they're a gray-amber translucent color. They turn darker within a week to 10 days as the fry develop. When that occurs, it's only a matter of days before they hatch. This turns the male into a stay-at-home dad, guarding the bed from predation. The next 4 to 6 weeks will be very stressful for the male, particularly with increased populations of round goby and rusty crayfish. He won't eat at all until the fry have hatched, and some even starve during the process. Not only does he have to fight off invasive species, but there's a host of natural predators as well. The best beds are built beside logs or rocks with heavy gravel for the eggs to tuck down into. All of this makes the job of protecting the eggs much easier. It is exhausting to protect a bed with no cornerstone or log to back into. Beds that are built out in the open typically have a much lower fry yield. Males become very aggressive when the fry are ready to hatch. They'll charge at much larger fish or even humans standing in the water. They'll even shoot up at a boat. When the fry hatch, they're colorless and featureless. They'll develop their pigmentation over the next few days. The male will stay with the fry for a few weeks while they grow and finally wander too far off the bed. At that point, his job's done. He'll move away from the fry and start a feeding binge.
Alright, so this is a smallmouth bass. It was caught on the Umatilla River. We're going to do a dissection on it, but before we're going to look at the outside. So these are obviously the tail fins. This is the dorsal, ow, pokey. This is the dorsal fin. Little spikes. And this is the anal fin. And obviously they're covered in scales, like most fish, but they're still pretty slimy, so I'll open her up. You see, slippery. Ouch. This thing's poking into me. This one's a bloody fish, that means it's healthy. Cut down. Shoot. Alright, so when we open it up, sorry. We'll look out. This here is the heart. I'm trying to get it in here. Can you zoom in on it? Can you see it? I don't know if the light's very good. The heart right here towards the top of the head. You can't see it very well. Here's a one from a smaller fish from earlier. It's actually still pumping, if you can see it, which that's pretty cool. I don't know if you still see that. Anyway. Below the heart is the liver. The liver is right there. There's the other one that we cut out earlier. And then connecting from, that's the, this, here, this back part is right here. This long tube here is the stomach, which the throat's back up here. Here's the, oops, this is the one that we cut out from the one earlier. And then these long finger looking things that you can see right here. It's called the pilic casa, which we're not really sure what the purpose of them are. There's another one that I cut out from earlier. Kind of look like the little slap hands that you get out of the quarter machines. I'm trying to get some of this out of the way. See this big sack right here? This is the swim bladder, which they don't use it like an actual bladder like us. It's filled with gas for their buoyancy. And then here's one from the smaller one that we cut out earlier. It's still got gas in it. So, actually, I'll show them the gills now, since I was going to do that later. These are the gills, which are behind the gill flap. They, these are called, these little white things are called the gill filaments. And they filter out, like, rocks and stuff when they drink through water. This one's got a huge swim bladder. Because it's bigger than, a lot bigger than the other one. This one's actually a male. This one doesn't have eggs, it has testes, which I'll try and find them here in a second. Oh no! Ooh, he's actually got something in his stomach. I want to see what it is. Oh, it's a little crawdad. Yep, a little crawdad. There's his little pinchers. Bigger fish will eat crawdad. Oops. Sweet deal. Alright, so that was a male. So that one had testes, which I think are somewhere right there. But the one that we cut open earlier was a female. And that was the ovary. Here's the ovaries. They have the little eggs in them. Sorry, my hands are nasty. But yeah, that's pretty much it. They're not really that complicated.